Good afternoon. Welcome to the August 21st meeting of the Franklin Historic Zoning Commission's Design Review Committee. The DRC is a subcommittee of historic zoning. The meeting is informal and designed to guide applicants through the process of obtaining a certificate of appropriateness, or COA, for projects within the city's historic districts in light of the historic district design guidelines. Applicant participation in DRC meetings is voluntary but highly recommended. Changes made or suggestions taken by the applicant based on discussions with the DRC are the applicant's choice, but the DRC makes no representation as to whether any of the changes or suggestions made during the meeting will be approved by the voting body, which is the Historic Zoning Commission. There are 7 items on the afternoon's agenda. When the item's called, please introduce yourself and generally describe your item in about 3 to 5 minutes. So our first item today is consideration of the addition to the principal at 1303 Adams Street. Yep, green light.
Green light. We're learning. Hey, y'all. David Swift, 1303 Adams Street. Good to see you tonight. Wanted to go over a few changes that we've made from last time here. Had a couple comments directly in the last meeting. Wanted to touch base on those. There was an issue with siding under the back window. Hey, Hannah. Siding under the back window here. This was one little minor item that was mentioned as an addendum. We changed that in design. That was just a little visual piece here. That's been changed. The window's been raised. We've got siding underneath. And then basically the main issue here was kind of, if we look at the side piece here, I'm kind of jumping in, I think we're maybe largely familiar with this, but can we scroll down just a hair to kind of show that side piece there? There was an issue here. We've also added an additional, photo here. I want to show you some adjustments we've made on this since last time. There was a request to kind of bring the massing down some on this. We have brought it down a couple of feet. It's really close to where it was prior for the first kind of version of it was technically a couple versions ago, but version before. Also there was an issue Tyler had mentioned, not liking to see the siding from the front view here. We've erased that, brought it down enough where that's not an issue anymore. In addition, if we could scroll up a little bit more, or maybe go further down the document, excuse me. Wanted to kind of point out this. So we added this in so you can kind of see, because the side elevation doesn't quite show this step back. You know, there's a little bit of an issue with the massing here on this piece. There was also a request to technically bring the square footage down. So we did that again, additionally. We brought it down another percentage piece on this. So trying to really work on that front here to kind of make this design work. We think this is probably what makes the most sense, what's most appropriate to kind of trying to figure everything out here. But you'll see this piece on the back of the house, we've stepped that back to kind of give that a different dimension on just there being an issue with kind of it being, you know, one kind of wall there. We included obviously a 3D piece of this to kind of give you a different viewpoint so you can see that on here. That's really the main points. Just to kind of quick recap, we mentioned last time, we're not able to do an additional building on this location. We're already maxed out, hence this kind of concept and everything else. So anyways, we would really, I guess maybe one piece I just want to add, like, we're obviously trying to get some extra square footage with this. You know, we're not trying to, this isn't like, hey, we've really got to fit the bowling alley in here, you know? This is an extra bedroom, playroom for our daughter and an adoption that we would like to pursue. So, this is to accommodate that. So really hoping that kind of what we brought today is something more appropriate that you guys would like.
Okay. Anything Joy? Else? Oh, wait a minute. Did you, your architect has stepped in. So
yes.
I'm
Hi. No, sorry, I'm late.
Thank you. And I was not present at last month's meeting, or just a week ago's meeting. So I did go back and review some of the comments that were made. And just to recap what Mr. Swift said, they have brought down the roof line. If you look at the side elevation, so it's not What's that say? 2 feet lower than the roof ridge along the main historic form of the home. And then just going back to the front elevation, this area right here is that newer addition. So the roof eave is tucked behind that side addition on the main form of the house. So I think it's more in keeping with the 1.5 kind of scale. That 3D, that rear, the most rear, rearmost, rearmost addition, there you go, is inset. So it is a little bit better hidden from public view. So those are the changes that have been made, as well as the reduction in the footprints to get it down to 50%.
Okay, good. I'm going to start with Tyler this time.
All right.
Talk to us, Tyler.
I think several things you did here moved definitely in the right direction. I think the inset helps. You know, the eave changing heights on that, the garage massing helps. So we don't see that siding from the front. All the things you hit on are good. That kind of two-story mass in the back still concerns me a little bit because it's, you know, we generally don't like to see, or I don't like to see, and I don't think the guidelines recommend any full two-story additions behind story and a half houses. It's still difficult for me there, but it is totally hidden from view. But you have neighbors, I guess there's just the one neighbor could ever see this thing, you know, be curious what they think about it, but.
Can I interject too? There actually is a second story. So we're actually taking a second story. We're actually removing a piece of the second story.
Okay.
In this, but there is currently a second story in the house.
Is it just in the attic though?
It's over the kitchen.
Over the kitchen?
It's like an office.
Well, that, yeah.
I think he used mm-hmm. it as an office.
Yeah, right? It's an additional office space. Yeah. There's currently like an outdoor patio that actually enters into the second story currently.
Okay. Well, you know, when you submit, I mean, it'd be good to see kind of the as-built conditions too, because some of those things play in. You know, I think this feels different, a little bit different, but that just that one corner. I mean, you look at the 3D, the very last slide. It's this two-story box that's kind of salt boxed off the back, and it is one. It's two stories, and two, it's a form, just a shape that's not common to kind of any historic structure, those are kind of two things that are, you know, kind of hard for me to swallow on this one, but at least it's hidden, and in those regards, I mean, we're not here to tell you what you can't have. We're here to protect the public interest, and so from the public's perspective, I think you've done a good job of masking it. You know, I also don't want to the next person to show up and say, well, so-and-so got two stories behind their house. Can I do something similar, and why not? We generally discourage that much mass behind what appears to be a story and a half house, even if it had a second floor.
Sure.
I mean, it's a story and a half house.
Sure.
So that's my thoughts.
Yeah, another piece too, feedback, Tyler, if I may. I don't know if I'm allowed to. I think this is conversational.
Yep.
Is we certainly are wanting to take advantage of the grade on our end, right? It's maybe a little bit harder to see on some of these images, but the whole lot slopes to the back. So certainly say, hey, you know, flat lot, you've got a, you know, a monster of a thing up there, but it kind of is, you know, from the eye hidden, you know, as it comes down, like we're obviously saying, hey, like we could bring, you know, I mean, like we would mess with all the floors and everything, right, to make it lower, but we're just trying to obviously, you know, optimize that piece as well.
Susan?
I would echo what Tyler has to say, and I'll just be real frank with you. I don't think I can support this. I think that if I were on the street view and I came around and I saw this two-story at the back, to me that's not sympathetic to the original house. So I won't be able to support. And I don't have my...
Say it all again.
All right. There we go. So I honestly will not be able to support this. I just feel like it's not sympathetic to the House. And Tyler mentioned something about we're trying to, you know, preserve the character of Franklin. And I think that's the whole thing. We're trying to preserve, I mean, a house like this is a gem.
Oh,
and we don't have that many of this in Franklin. And I think we're, our idea is to try to preserve the feel of the house. And it's not has anything to do with, you know, saying you can't have this, you can't have that. It's what we're trying to do as a whole for the community. Thank you.
Josh.
Yeah. I think my question has been answered, but that rear addition, so the garage piece, is that flush with the front piece? Because when I mean, I know there's a gap in there, but as far as how far it comes out, when I looked at the front elevation, I couldn't really tell whether that was the roof line of the original structure or if it, like, you can kind of see the back portion behind it. So it does come all the way out even.
So on the side elevation,
hit your microphone there. Could you hit the button?
Me too. Sorry. Me too.
On the side elevation, looking at the garage, it is even with one another, but from the front elevation, you see the, so you see what's grayed out on the left, further left?
Yeah.
That is existing. So you have a gray line kind of not halfway, really.
Right. That's
so that's the edge of
the front roof.
The front roof, and so you only see that rectangle of new roof,
right,
which will match.
Yep.
We're saying everything will match the existing.
Yeah. I think that's, I think the 3D modeling is super helpful from my understanding. I think if there's any way you could shift that, because that I think is just hard for me to understand how that's going to look in reality, like with this kind of roof set back, pulled back up. And then I guess on the pergola in the back, I know it's clearly shown as kind of a, I've not seen a pergola like that where it comes to a roof form, but I guess there's, would there be any intent to put anything over that at some point in time in the future? Or?
No. That's the extent of my
understanding.
Our understanding is that's considered footprint, right? So, I mean, that's kind of the reason is like, hey, we probably not going to be able to add that piece on. Trying to, you know, make as much of that as we can.
Sure. Okay. Well, that was the clarifying question I had. That just looks like the skeleton of what's going to ultimately be covered, you know, whether it be with material or something that's not permanent. That's kind of what it looks like it's going for to me. So that was all I had, Mr. Chair.
Brian.
I think I could share some of what Josh is saying about the 3D version. It'd be nice to see that from the front when you come back, because this is a great view for us to see. And I do still, it is my opinion that the addition is out of proportion to the massing of the original structure, because it's really a one-story form that could be 1.5, you know, with using your attic space. And then to put the two-story form on the back, it's a disconnect. And just exploring, you know, since this is DRC and ideas, I noticed that at the rear of the 3D structure, we're seeing a little building. Is that the pool house? Is that what that is?
It's existing.
And
it's not the pool house. That's the existing shed.
It's just a shed.
Correct.
Yeah.
And the pool house is way further back.
Right. I know that right now you have two outbuildings currently, so you really can't put a third. But I was wondering if you would be able to take that one and alter it into like a garage or make a connector that went to the house that was open. I don't know codes wise what that actually does. I don't know if it would let you consider that a part of the house or another. Would it be part of the house if it were connected?
If it's connected by a breezeway and non-conditioned space, it would still be considered an accessory structure. That's to try to give more flexibility for accessory structures.
And if that were to happen to an existing accessory structure being altered that's grandfathered in, would it be a violation or could they do something like that?
I'm not sure I understand the question. If they expanded the accessory structure
that's
and
right.
added a breezeway, that would just be something that would be up to the the commission to approve.
But the question goes to zoning. So zoning allows two accessory structures. So if you're in violation already because you're grandfathered in, and you alter one of those.
Both buildings are oversized.
So you can't increase the degree of nonconformity.
Okay. All right, so we're back.
Another piece too. It's a carport. Mr. Roberts has seen, he lives on the street, is barely hanging on. it's barely hanging on.
You would completely redo it. Would have been my thing, but zoning.
Yeah.
That's a non question now. So.
Sure.
But anyway, the I would like to see that massing addressed.
And the massing, clarify that. Which massing?
The massing of the addition that looks like a two-story house.
But you've got a two-story addition. You've got a two-story part of the house that's already on the back.
It's a story and a half. The picture shows it. It's just the attic, but it has a room up there.
Yeah, it's not a real two-story form. And even if that would have been an addition at some point, if that were the case.
Probably in the 90s, probably.
I have a quick question for Kelly. If you attach that building with a breezeway, does that change the setbacks from property lines because it becomes part, or is it because it's not enclosed, it would not change the setbacks?
The accessory structure would need to adhere to the accessory structure setbacks, regardless of whether there's a breezeway to it, which usually that's 5 feet from side and rear lot lines.
So I guess my question is, the setbacks change once you become an attached addition as opposed to a different building? Or are they the same setbacks for both?
There are different setbacks typically for the principal structure or the house than there are for the accessory structure. The accessory structure is usually allowed to be closer to a side or rear lot line than the principal building is, simply because it is accessory and subordinate to the primary structure.
Is that all you had, Brian?
It is, Mr. Chair.
Okay, Lisa.
So based on what the applicant pointed out regarding the grade, I think that's something that is reassuring in terms of the visibility of the addition, and it satisfies the guidelines technically. And to Tyler's point regarding the sort of the difference in style, one thing that the guidelines does mention is that we don't want structures to try to mimic the historic structure. And you've done this, you've differentiated it instead of trying to copy the old structure, which in my opinion makes the historic structure even more of eye catcher from the street. And I agree with Mr. Laster that a 3D composition of the street view would be very, very helpful.
Okay, well, there are several things. One, I'm appreciative of the Swifts. I guess this is maybe fourth, fifth time you've been before us. So it's been a project. This house has been under-maintained, let me just say that, since 2001. And I know that because I know the previous owner to the people that you bought it from, and so I know that. And so I'm delighted that Swifts are coming on board to help rehabilitate this structure. What has been shown here, we've worked through the rear of the house, the front of the house, and all of that. What I believe you have shown here in this latest version will be seen maybe a bit on the right side above that real one-story part on the left. and that's all. You cannot see, I cannot see anything on the back now, and I'm by there pretty frequently, as it exists. And I think what you've done on the back is a lot better than what exists on the back currently. So I'm fine with what you've got as shown in the additions, the dropping that roof line 2 feet. And I think there was a comment about the foundation stone, and you've addressed that from the last meeting. So I'm fine with what you got. I do think you need to show a better representation of what it looks like on the back with the whole view when you come back, and not just this corner. Pardon me?
As it sits now?
Yes, as it sits now. And it would be great if you can superimpose what the new part would look like on that photograph, because I think that would help. But one driving up and down Adams Street right now, you're going to see very little of what you do from an addition standpoint, if anything. So I mean that's my two cents, having lived on Adams Street for 45 years. So anyway, that's it. So does anybody have anything else?
Can I just throw in one more comment too, just in terms of kind of layout piece and just sort of what's visible? And obviously, you know, we love the house. We're not trying to make it a tall and skinny, right? On the left side of the driveway is a tree line on both sides of a waterway. So there's no neighbors to the, like, if this is the house, there's a neighbor on the right, no one lives there. There's no neighbors on the left. It's just full wooded tree line on both sides. It's actually two tree lines all the way down.
Well, it's actually a drainage ditch.
Drainage ditch, yeah. Well, two tree lines on each side of that drainage ditch. Yeah, they're growing up on both sides. So just a thought on that piece.
And that would be good to show that, perhaps, when you do a front view.
There's a picture in the bottom left, the existing page. I'd love to, the bottom left picture, if you could drop your 3D thing right there. We'd know exactly what that looks like.
Right.
And you know, there is some grade drop. It's not a ton, but it's.
Well, it'd be nice to know that.
3 or 4 feet. So.
The specifics on that. I know it drops, but it's be good if you had that information.
Okay.
Anything else? Okay, we're done.
Thanks, y'all.
Thank
Appreciate you.
Okay, our next item is discussion of alterations, roof, chimney, repointing, refinishing of doors, fence, and driveway at 245 3rd Avenue North. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is Matt Burnett. I'm the property owner at 245 3rd. I just recently purchased it, and I'm just looking to get it back to an operating condition. It's all specimen deferred maintenance over the years, and I don't think I'm looking to do anything too.
Did you start over?
It's
over. Okay. Anything too significant, but obviously want to be respectful of the historical nature and location of the property. I have some questions also as to like what some additional things that have come up just in the last few days that may or may not be feasible, but the big ones out of the gates are the replacement of the roof and refinishing of the front door and adding a gate to the property.
Okay, staff.
So just like Matt said, that they're proposing to replace the existing asphalt roof with a new asphalt roof. They're also proposing to repoint the chimney, and the replacement of the asphalt roof with a new asphalt roof is supported by the guidelines. Same with repointing of the chimney. So with the front door, so here is an up close photo of the front door, and here's kind of it backed away a little bit, and they're proposing to kind of strip the paint off of it and so have it to be a natural wood look of the door. And the guidelines state that one should preserve, maintain the original entrance locations and, you know, leave unpainted doors unpainted. But since they're removing it, you know, this gets it back to what it originally was, potentially. Also within the application, this is the current side door, and it is in poor condition. But the applicant is proposing to replace it with a new side door that is, a new one was found on the property, so they're proposing to replace it with the exact same one. And that would also be fine within the guidelines. With, additionally, they're proposing to replace the existing fence, let's see, on here. So it'd face North Margin Street. And so because this property is located within the flood fringe overlay, the walls and open fencing, such as horseboard fencing, wrought iron, aluminum fencing, or flap gate systems are the only types of fencing allowed, as it is not intended to block the flow of water. The new fence height would need to be brought up to the current zoning ordinance requirements. And since this is a corner lot, it's unique that it would have to be the 3 feet in the front yard and then go to the standard 7 foot in the rear yard for like maximum ones. And then,
am I allowed to jump in and ask a question on that?
Sure.
So the backyard has to, it has to be updated to a 7 foot high fence?
So I think that it's maximum 7 foot.
Maximum, okay.
Yes.
Is, okay.
And then the last thing within this application is to propose to have a additional driveway on that would face North Margin Street. And we had this reviewed by our engineering team, and the proposed additional driveway access from North Margin Street is tentatively approved by the city engineer pending review of the plot plan for final location. Thank
so
you.
So that's a yes.
Yes. Right. As long as y'all say it's okay, you know.
Okay. Who wants to start? Susan?
It sounds like a good proposal to me. So
Josh,
I'm fine.
Thanks for coming. That's what I would say. Thanks for coming to see us. And yeah, I don't have any comments.
Brian,
I said congratulations on your new purchase. It's a great house. I've often admired it. A couple of comments. One, I know you're proposing to do some kind of standing seam metal for the porch, and then asphalt shingles. What you find in a lot of homes that have the wing and gable in Franklin is the porch actually goes up under the eave. And then when you put a metal roof, it goes up under the eave, and then you have the other roof coming down on top of it. So when you have asphalt coming like that and then metal, you know, it's a decent look. But this particular porch roof actually sits on top of your roof. And whenever you do a metal, you're going to have some kind of a very heavy looking band that sits at the top, so to help with water mitigation, unless, you know, a roofer can find some other. So I think I would recommend either doing all asphalt, you know, you can look into alternatives for that, or all metal for that roofing situation.
Yeah, we're actually, it's funny, that's that exact issue kind of came up this week with a contractor, and we're discussing that, actually, that very thing.
It's just a difficult transition to make because of the way it works.
It is, yeah. We may end up going all standing seam metal. Historically, from your guys' perspective, is there at the end of the day, is there an issue with any of those options? If it's a blend of the, if it winds up being a workable solution with the asphalt and then the standing seam on the porch, or if it goes, ends up going all standing seam metal roof, is that are there any issues with that, with the historical nature, or is
I can only speak for myself on that, so all standing seam would be fine with me. And on the other, I just have to see how the transition works.
Okay.
So on the chimneys, now you're going to repoint your chimneys.
Yes.
You know, those chimneys almost look like they've probably been, some bricks have been taken off probably in the past and lowered. And just a thought, I mean, it's nothing that you have to do, but just a thought that if looked at some of the other examples of chimneys in the area, that they might need to be a little taller. It might actually help it aesthetically. On your front door, I would recommend after it's been stripped in the, with the paint, that you go back with a product called Waterlox. Waterlox is a natural product. It has ester gums in it, helps it dry better outside for outside use. It's used in marine environments, and yet it's a natural product. You don't have, it's not like a polyurethane. And I think that ends my comments. Thank you.
You're talking about the door he wants to refinish, the wood door.
That's right.
Okay.
After the paint has been removed.
Yes, yes, yes.
You'll want to go back with a finish to protect it.
Go ahead, Emily.
Can I add that the guidelines would recommend that to utilize a roofing material that was historically there, so the asphalt roofing would be recommended over standing seam.
One more comment on that. What I would assume that house originally had were cedar shakes. That's what it would originally had. And then I know that other people did use standing seam metal roofs on houses of that similar nature. So, and I know that the guidelines recommend asphalt, but you know, you can always ask the Historic Zoning Commission for, you know, for the ask, whatever.
What were you thinking on your, if you went standing seam, what would you do? What kind of finish would you have on that, or would you? Are you thinking copper?
No, I was thinking more of like just like a dark, like a gray, or like a, almost like a...
A pre-finish type.
Yeah. Or it could be, I mean, copper if you... I mean, I definitely want to be historically, you know, respectful of that, and I'm by no means an expert on that, so that's partly why I'm here. So if the input is that copper is more, you know, befitting the time period than copper.
I have to interject on that. A house of this style and would probably not have had copper.
Yeah.
Just they're so expensive, okay. Even today.
Okay.
Your roofer can guide you too on that. Roofer can guide you on that.
Can I actually ask one more question that's not on here that we're looking at? And I don't know if this gets triggered by when we go in for permits on interior stuff and various upgrades to the property for ADA compliance and whatnot, but the driveway right now actually is a blend. It's half, it's concrete about halfway up, and then it goes to just gravel. Is that something that also falls within the historical guidelines as far as what we may wind up doing with that driveway? I'm not sure if I'm
staff. You want to comment on that?
So I mean, it would have to. We'd have to look into it further, but we would just have to look into it further.
But it would be something that would be reviewed by the commission if there was a change in material.
Okay.
Yeah, I just wasn't sure if I'd be required to update or change it because of a like an ADA compliance issue or something, but.
Emily's right. We would have to look into that aspect of it with our counterparts in the Building and Neighborhood Services. It ultimately depends on the use of the building.
My suggestion would be for you to work with staff on whatever you think you want to do on that driveway before it comes back to us. Tyler?
Yeah, just following up on what others have said, I think, you know, easiest thing to do is do the shingle roof through and through from front to back, including the porch, because we know it's a historic material that was used because it's there today. If you want something else, I'd just be very clear to what your proposal is. We don't, you know, typically offer up options necessarily. We want to hear what you want to do, but the guidelines should give you a pretty good idea of what's allowable, and then staff can certainly supplement those guidelines and are usually happy to do that. But, you know, door refinishing, don't have any problems with that. Looks like that side door, is it a metal door now?
No, it's a solid wood
door. Is it?
Door, yeah.
Okay. Look, some of the paint on it looked
It's hard to tell.
Suspect at the bottom.
Yeah, it's there's some rot, and there's a couple broken. It's actually got a crack through the panel, but there is an identical one we found in an interior
okay.
closet.
Huh. And it looks like that the head on that door is about 2 inches out of square.
Yeah.
So I just say that because if you try and put the other door in there, you may be better served by trying to fix that one because it fits the hole already. But you know, good luck. You know, whatever you want to try. But yeah, I don't see any problems with this. Just the roofing thing, we're reluctant to let people in previous projects just come in and put something that's not there up there. And we're a little more lenient on porches and such, but we've seen some houses similar to yours that have that type of roof transition where it kind of kicks out at a new pitch, and there's not an actual break
right.
in the roof. And we typically recommend just sticking with one material because it will look better and frankly, it performs better that way
mm-hmm.
From a waterproofing perspective. So that's my comments.
Thank you. Lisa?
Agree with the all asphalt that Tyler was talking about. It gives the historic structure, I think, a greater homage, I guess you could say, versus the standing seam, which could potentially be a distraction. Standing seams, I've seen sometimes turn out a bit more brilliant and distracting than you would expect. So all asphalt would be my recommendation. And the fencing is something that was briefly discussed. You're talking about picket fencing or?
Which, only because we saw some remnants of it on the mm-hmm. property and don't know what period, you know, when that was, but that's really about 4 feet of it there is the only section that's
mm-hmm.
laying around. So we do a white,
similar white style, mm-hmm. similar height too, which I think that's only about maybe four feet high,
mm-hmm.
three to 4 feet high.
Mm-hmm. And were you thinking the same height all the way around or?
Yes.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I like to try to keep the visibility to the, you know, to the street and even the cemetery
yeah.
across the way, not kind of close it in. So
yeah.
I'm trying to keep
yeah.
it more open and visible.
And we as a commission would definitely give a nod to that. Ms. Huffer mentioned the 7-foot height is the highest you could go on the back, you said, right?
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
It's the max height of 7 feet. But because of it's in the flood fringe overlay, the fence would have to be of a different kind of material. It'd have to be the horse board fencing and wrought iron or aluminum fencing, or it has to utilize a flap gate system.
Oh, okay.
On the back, where it turns in, right? Or
on the property because of
on the whole. So that whole margin street, I'm getting confused on what the picket, where is the picket fence going?
So
yes, it would have gone all the way along margin. I guess that's that it's a corner lot, so I kind of think of it as the side, but I guess a portion of that would be considered the back.
I'm following the red line on the drawing here that I'm looking at.
Mm-hmm.
And it potentially could be the rot-resistant wood with that flap gate system. We just have to look into it a little bit further.
Okay.
So that's a material that would fit the flood zone requirements, the one that you just mentioned?
The rot-resistant
uh-huh.
wood, I believe so. I'll just have to look into
oh, okay.
it just to double-check with our
okay.
zoning
uh-huh.
department.
Because it would look like a wood picket fence, correct? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And rot-resistant wood just means a type of wood that's more resistant to rot, like a cedar.
But you're, I'm still, I'm thick. Did you have anything else?
Well, only that I can't visualize, you know, a 3-foot fence height on the front and then going up to a 4-foot height on the back or 5. All in all, my recommendation would be the same height all the way around. That's all. Oh, and I did have another comment. You can come back to me later.
Scott, do you have any?
I have no comments. That was good.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the location of the driveway is I think, very appropriate as well.
Okay, I think before I talk about the fence, the roofing, I just think the asphalt shingle, you'd be better served with the asphalt shingle over that whole thing. And I do, I appreciate Brian's comments on the transition if you were to go with standing seam over the porch and then asphalt shingle. I think that was good advice. I still am thick on the fence. Is it your idea to put a white picket fence across the front of your property and then go down the side on Margin Street? Because you just said in the email, it said just on Margin. And then turn it in around that driveway in the back, and you're going to wipe out all that bush, that landscaping there?
So, I hope this gets me in trouble, but that bush is actually gone as today. It's more, okay, of a weed than a bush.
When you come, how about making a show us exactly what it looks like today?
Yes, but the fence, my idea was with the fencing, right now it starts, there would be no fence in the front of the property at all.
Okay, all right, that's
good. Would start about halfway down, you can't really see in that picture, but you can see the second window along Margin.
Yes.
Right past that window is where the fence starts. So there's kind of a tree at the back corner of that of the building right there. That's about where the fence starts from there back.
Okay. Okay. All right.
I could show that obviously on a.
Were you going to tie it into the house?
Yeah. So it tied into the house. It went from the edge of the house to Margin and then back.
So that looked like that'd be the 20-foot.
Because of the proposed driveway cut, that might change the height allowance depending on the location of the fence. So it may actually be lower than that so that we can have sight distance visibility.
My goal is actually have the lowest fence possible. The only reason I want a fence is to keep the dog in from time to time that I take to work with me. So
now we're getting to it.
Yeah.
Okay. So other than that, I don't have any other comments.
One other comment, Mr. Chair, and this would be on, if you go with the asphalt, you know, an architectural shake kind of a look might really help bring out what would have originally been there, which had been more shake. But Emily, if you zoom in on that outbuilding in the very back, you'll see that it had a metal roof on it, at least the outbuilding. And, you know, it may originally had, at some point, I don't know originally, but at some point had something similar to that. But I just want to point that out in the outbuilding. I often walk by that and admire the little outbuilding. It's nice.
Okay, anything else? We're good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. All right, discussion of alterations, front door at 302 Public Square. Welcome.
Hi there. I'm Andy Pulliam with Pulliam Design Studios Architects. We're the architect of record for this project. We're requesting to be able to replace existing front doors that are on the front of 302 Public Square. We've sent some photographs to staff indicating the condition that they exist in at the moment and some historic precedents that we think demonstrate that what is there now is not of a historic nature. It doesn't relate to anything prior to probably 1970-ish. There was a substantial fire there at the property in 1971 as a liquor store. And since then, it has been renovated at least once, possibly twice, for other tenants. We are currently under construction on the interior and renovating the interior for a bank here in Nashville that has a branch in Cool Springs, and this is their second Williamson County endeavor. So they're very excited to be on the square. We intend to go back with doors that match what is there. Right now, the doors have about 2 feet of wood paneling on the bottom portion, and then the remainder is all glass above. The existing doors that are there have severe rot and deterioration on both of the rails and the stiles on the bottom, as you can see there. And that's actually part of the new flooring in that photograph. And when the contractor needed to make a small undercut on the door to clear the flooring, that bottom rail kind of just all fell out. And so it's really hanging on by a prayer. And seeing that this is a bank location, trying to repair that with what's available, even commercially on the market, does not seem feasible to provide them the security that they're looking for in that door. So we are looking to replace those. They're painted now, and they will be painted wood doors in their new situation.
Staff?
Since that these current doors are not original to the building, we would, you know, be comfortable with a replacement door since that they are not the original doors on the property. Thank you.
Thank you. Comment, Susan?
I think it's a great idea, and I
appreciate you brought it here and let us comment on it. And yeah, I can see that they're not original, so this would be good. Thank you.
Josh?
Yep. No comment. Thank
Brad.
You.
You're right. They're not original. Back when Mr. Noah Tripp owned that liquor store, and back when Franklin had liquor stores and pool halls, wasn't quite as posh as it is today. So yes, they're not original. So I'm fine with it.
Tyler?
I'm glad to see that you're using a real wood door. I saw Masonite on there. I was like, all right, let me see what. But it is mahogany, and I think it'll be great. Go for it.
Lisa?
Agreed.
Scott?
I think it's great. Go for it.
All good. Thank you. Okay, discussion of additions, porch and dormer at 435 Boyd Mill.
Thank you. Well, once we came here last time, and they said that they didn't like the two stories, so we got rid of that one. But we made the columns a lot thinner, like y'all suggested. And the dormer you had mentioned, Tyler had mentioned, like lifting up, raising the window some and not showing as much siding to match like the other ones on Boyd. And we took some pictures so we could sort of match, not those were the house, but like the thinner columns, either rounded or squared. And then we have the big gable from that one house down there that we thought would match onto our front of our house for the option two. So we think that it matches more of the neighborhood now that we went down and looked at all the, you know, the houses on Boyd, and we think that it looks really good. And then we did a rear option as well to add on a second story over the sunroom that they have, and that's option three. So we just wanted to show you all that too, just in case we needed to go that route. So
option one was what you...
Option one and two are the ones that we fixed from the last time.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
We still have bracket. This is the option one,
right,
where we just have the roof and the thinner columns, and then the dormer that we got the higher windows. And then option two, we kept that one with the big gable because we thought that looked... That, you know, that gable at the end of the street with the three gables, I think it's 415 Boyd. I can't remember the address exactly. But we thought that would fit in. And we added the brackets on there as well, so to make it look a little more historic.
Okay, staff?
So just like Ms. Pam said, that they took inspiration from the other properties on Boyd Mill for like the porch inspiration. And I mean, the guidelines state that the one should design a roof line, bay, porch, or other element associated with an addition to be keeping in line with the scale of the surrounding historic buildings. The proposed option one blends with the other porch and column configurations that are seen on the Boyd Mill Avenue. For the dormer on this option one, and I think, and on option two, the dormers should be recessed at least 1 foot from the exterior building wall, and the sidewall should be at least 30 inches from the exterior building wall. So this would just need to be, the top of it would need to be scooted down just a little bit.
Oh, okay. That's doable.
And then with this, the third option with adding the addition on the rear, again, we would apply the same guideline that it should, you know, look to what is seen historically in the district. And because this is a non-historic house, it's just on the edge, but it offers a little bit more leniency for that. Thank you.
Okay, Susan?
So this is contemporary
infill, then,
is that correct?
Well, we're just adding on a new front porch.
Okay.
Yes, okay. And a dormer.
Yeah, this is not a historic house.
Correct, okay. Correct.
So I guess the, although aesthetically, I think option two is a nicer option,
I feel like that you have to use the context of the street, and I'm not sure that that fits the street quite as well as the option one.
The so option two doesn't fit as well. As
I don't feel like it does. Yeah. All right. So that's my comment. Thank you.
Josh.
Yep. I think option one seems more fitting. Maybe it's because I've seen the house kind of in that configuration for a long time, but I think it's so attractive, and I think they're both nice options. I just think option one fits better. And as far as the rear, the only thing when you zoom in, it looks like the roof line is right at the top. I just think from staff's perspective, I'd want to make sure we're dropping that down so you wouldn't see anything popping up over the back, which I can't imagine you would, but great.
Okay, and then I can lower the plate height, so that would all work.
I don't even know that you need to. I just think we just need to make sure it meets that guideline where we're not, you know, we're sufficient there, and I'm sure it is.
Okay, thank you.
Brian?
I agree. I think option one has a classic simplicity.
Okay, perfect.
Tyler?
I agree, the option one, and I think the other one has a lot of detailing, but it can also be thought of as kind of a manufactured kind of historic feel to the second one. So the other thing is I'm looking at, if you can scroll up to option one's front elevation there, the side elevation for some reason doesn't jive in my head. Is that front? So you've got the front of this lower mass just in front of the chimney.
Yes.
That roof line continues through, is that correct?
Yes. What it is that right there where she had the pointer, that really stretches all the way up.
Okay, so that line would continue on. Just and the dormer would be in the background.
Correct. The dormer would be in the background.
That looks like the old side elevation. Doesn't, because I don't see a dormer at all.
Well, that part there that's going up and down, that's the dormer. I stopped the dormer there.
Okay.
It doesn't go all the way across the...
Are you going to change the pitch of that front?
I'm not changing the pitch. The pitch is staying the same. I was just extending the garage up somewhat so we could get some head height over that garage where we can add a second story and then just drop it and then make that the dormer.
Okay.
But it won't go all the way across.
Yeah, I would have expected to match the front, we should see a complete gable and a dormer in the background in that coming off the ridge. Right now we see that jog and it doesn't match the front elevation. So just make sure all those go together nicely, because it has to do with that, what everybody's queuing on that ridge and where the dormer ridge ties into the original ridge, so.
Okay, gotcha.
Lisa?
With the changes to the dormer that Tyler was referring to, option one, I think is the right one.
All right, thank you.
Scott?
I like option one. It looks good.
Okay, thank you.
It'll be unanimous then.
Unanimous.
Yeah.
And I think Tyler's right is on showing that dormer.
I'll fix that up and show it to you. Yes, definitely. I had it on the plan and I think that I missed it on the, totally on the dormer.
Yeah, because option three, which shows the back, shows the different roof lines.
Right, on, yes, on option three.
And when you come for a vote, I wouldn't show your other options, just.
Right, just.
Don't confuse things.
So the next step, do I, we have to come back here again or do we go straight through codes?
If you're ready and.
Okay.
You have to go to, you have to come before the.
The voting meeting.
Oh, there's another.
Historic zoning commission meeting, yeah.
Design review.
Oh, okay, so I have to come through, okay.
And I'll send you a link with it and with our recap, so it'll be easy.
Thank you, dear. Thanks for all your help.
Oh, yes. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Thank you.
All right, thank you all so much for your time.
All right. Kelly, I don't see anybody from on the Magnolia Hall, the William Campbell Court lots.
Get to go home. Should we take a 5-minute break and give them a minute?
Yeah, let's take a 5-minute break and do you want to check with Matt?
I suggest a 5-minute break.
I'll second that.
We back in session on the...
Big trouble, mister.
Y'all.
Well. Yeah. Yeah. All right, we're ready for Nooch Construction at 1841 William Campbell Court, Lot 5.
Okay, so, Lot 5, you, I'm not sure if you had seen that before. The design had started with this scheme, had migrated over to a classical scheme, which we just felt just wasn't working right. And so it has since migrated back to the folk Victorian type of style. And I just wanted to get your feedback on it. You know, first of all, do you have any questions on it or anything like that? And just to get your feedback.
Okay, staff.
So this is the first time that this house has been to a DRC meeting. So,
okay.
So first off, with the porches, the guidelines would recommend that they should use a more simpler design, and that they do not use ornate milled columns, variation of Greek orders, or craftsman style columns on the porches. Additionally, the turret over here, that its height should be reduced to, you know, something similar to what was approved, I believe, on house number 2. That is the first one on this road. The guidelines recommend that architectural features should complement but not visually compete with the character of nearby historic structures. And this one is going to be right by, a little bit right before you get to the historic Magnolia Hall. Here we go. Okay, so this one is Lot 5, and so here is it in relation to the mansion. So it's just right before you get to the mansion. Thank you.
Okay. All right, comments. Scott, you start it this time.
And, if I could interrupt, could you show them the, just flash up the precedent images on this too, just for context? Okay. Okay. Thanks.
Okay, sorry. Scott.
Overall, I get that I agree with staff that the porch should be a simple, not so ornate, just stand out, but that's what I have in the comments.
Lisa?
Simplicity, simplicity, simplicity. I agree with staff that the ornate nature of the columns and even the turret, the height of the turret, all of that detracts from the historic Magnolia Hall building.
You should have seen it before.
All right, Tyler.
Yeah, the I think the round porch there, you know, I you probably had a similar reaction to me and thought, ah, it's not really a turret. It's not way up in the air. But it's a round porch, and it is a prominent element on the front, especially driving up the road. I think it's it brings a busyness to the front of this that I think just is too much maybe. I think it might be more successful to just take the front porch and carry it across. I see you've got a little jog in that front room, which is a study or something. I don't know. I could see the porch getting a little deeper towards the front yard to kind of make up for what you lose in that round porch. But you might be able to pull that front room back a little too, just some in between, maybe a little of both, just to give it, because it is some outdoor living space. I mean, to give up the round porch, I don't think that it's round is what's bugging us. I think that it's a roof mass with a lot of millwork holding it up that is holding weight against what is already a pretty decorative element, which is this primary front gable. The right gable is kind of the main mass in that historic form. And so to have this other piece there and another little piece of roof tends to compete with that in a way. I think the asymmetry of this style of house is kind of a common thing. So I think just a simple shed roof like you've done over the front door that's carried across, even if you make that a little deeper towards the front or push the main wall back a little bit, could get you where you need to in terms of program, but I think it would be a simpler elevation.
Brian?
So carrying with that thought of the front porch, when I first looked at the, I thought that was board and batten, but I think it's like a standing seam porch that you're seeing coming over the front door.
Oh, I'm sorry. That's standing seam metal roof.
And so I think that would, to do away with the turret look, the rounded porch, and carry your post straight across, would probably look more in keeping with what we traditionally see in Franklin. Another couple of comments I had on this was on the height. So we know Magnolia Hall, we're told it's 32 feet in height, and we're showing this really at 31. It says 30 and 11 inches. So I agree with staff, if we could probably pull that down some, especially since it's so close to the house, that might help with this some. And my other comment is the fascia board, which when I'm looking at it would be on the right where the gable comes down. It looks like a very long fascia board.
That's actually a piece that's set back about 12 feet from the front face. And it's like a bay window element, and the roof continues on down. So
it is a long,
I think there's roof. A missing piece of shadow which would have separated those two pieces.
If it's like a bay, it might look better to be underneath, have a shed roof underneath that, rather than looking like that roof line comes all the way down. Unless it's a 3D and I can't see what's behind it. Mm-hmm.
I think that's mm-hmm. There's supposed to be some lines there that match that side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the limitations of elevation sometimes. I definitely hear your comments. I understand definitely where you're coming from.
And one other question, just because we've seen it so much, the transoms above windows,
mm-hmm.
and we can't really see that past the frieze of that turret thing. They're not. We don't have transoms above those windows, do we? Okay.
Correct.
Thank you.
So the only transom is over the front door, and then that triple window at the front.
And you know, I like a Queen Anne style. I like the stick Victorian Queen Anne style of this. Were those be you proposing shakes in the gable?
Yes, and I was proposing diamond-shaped shakes up there. I know that we don't consider color here, but I was thinking in terms of a monocolor like a white or something like that for everything, rather than popping the elements out with color, because I think the shadows and the forms are doing enough. So as I was designing it, that's one thing I had in mind. And then, by the way, the turn posts would be sourced from a place where I could submit whatever design I wanted to, and then they would just fabricate it. And the same would go for the porch post brackets and corbels, that those would be custom executed as well. So it could be, I wouldn't be limited by a catalog.
And typically on a Queen Anne, you would see turn posts.
And and as the examples show, there's quite a few examples. Also wanted to contrast it with the Tuscan columns of Lot 2. And of course I've developed this, refined it as I continue to look at it. For instance, the dormer is quite different, and that's going to differentiate it from Lot 2. Further, the thing with the porch, I understand, exactly where you're coming from, and I had the same questions regarding the round form. In the end, I wanted to make a place, an outdoor room, and that was really driving it. And I also didn't want the entire porch in front of that front-facing gable, which has the chamfered corners. I kind of wanted those to stand proud. And in front of the porch, if possible. But I can certainly take your comments under consideration and take a look at that again.
Thank you. Thank you, Matt.
Yeah.
Josh. Okay. I think it would help to, I kind of echo the whole simplicity thing and that my fellow commissioners have mentioned. I think it would be helpful. We don't have side elevations of this one yet, do we? Yeah. No. I think that could either help or hurt on the simplicity piece from my view, because this is in kind of a curve. It's pretty close proximity to the mansion, but I think what to me may appear too decorative in context may look not so decorative, or vice versa. But I really think we need to see that kind of perspective as you're coming around those curves both 3D. Ways, because it could kind of go away in a lot of ways, depending on how it looks.
Okay.
Susan?
Well, I tend to think of this as more the stick style in terms of the style. I definitely simplify the porch. I think that it is very complex, and something simpler would be better. Lowering the roof line would actually, I believe, help the proportions of the house. I think overall, right now, when I look at this, it's always like, as a designer, it's like, what's the first thing I see when I look at something? And the first thing I see is that roof line. And so lowering that roof line, I feel like, would really make the house a better option. And one of the things that, and this, you know, is like, you have precedents. So are these precedents from Franklin, Tennessee, or they're from, you know, different places? Because I don't recognize at least one of these from being from Franklin. Okay. So, you know, definitely.
I want to make sure that is the top left. What is the
that
caption?
That top left does not look familiar to me, but.
It's
got an address.
Yeah.
All right. Thank
if it
you.
Has an address, that would be Franklin.
Okay. Wonderful. And Thank you. It was so tiny. Okay.
But then the lower left one is not.
Okay.
But as I said, you know, like, for instance, the color scheme of the upper right one, which is on south margin, or is it on, I guess it's facing.
It's on, it faces forward.
Faces forth,
but yeah.
That's a very aggressive.
It's on margin. That elevation is on margin.
Yes. And that's those chamfered corners is in those brackets, which then hold up the gable. That's that same move that I'm proposing. As well as that raked soffit, although I'm not ornamenting the barge board as much as they are on theirs. But you can see some of the cues. And I looked at that for the general height and massing. If you look at that gable on that house, the double windows and space above those double windows, and then the attic window above that, I studied that a bit. And again, I'm referencing that top right photo.
Okay.
The Fourth Avenue one. Okay.
So I know we don't talk about color, but you're not thinking of it being all white, are you?
I kind of like the monochrome. It sounds like you probably don't want all white.
I think that that's a trend, and that, you know, I would expect to see this type of house painted in a complex color scheme. So that I would, I mean, I know we don't comment on that, but that's just my own comment as a designer. Thank you.
Okay.
I would agree on simplification of the porch, and I do agree on lowering that roof line. I think Susan's right. I think when you look at this elevation, the first thing I notice is that roof line.
Yeah.
It just looks like a pyramid. So I think that would help. And I do think across the front, it just needs some simplification there on that porch. So that's all I can add. Emily?
So would y'all want this application to come back to DRC for another round of y'all to look at it?
I think that's up to the applicant.
Mm-hmm.
It may help. It might help.
And
I don't want to get into a, excuse me, Matt, I don't want to get into a voting meeting and have cover the same thing again.
Yeah.
That we've covered here. If another pass at DRC would be helpful.
Okay. Then to clarify, simplifying the front, are you talking more about the round
yes.
porch, or are you talking more about the columns? Because the columns, and by the way, I have relooked at the porch post brackets that kind of create an arch effect, and they're now smaller and more and simpler, so they are simpler now. But one reason I chose turned columns, right, in addition to it being precedent, is to provide differentiation from the other homes on the street. And so...
Yeah, I don't... I feel fine about the turned columns. I know the guidelines recommend against it, but in a infill development that is of this magnitude where we are scratching and clawing for some variety, I think it's perfectly appropriate. And we have precedent. We have a whole page of things in Franklin that have turned columns. So I don't have a problem with that. I think the brackets, you know, as long as they're tastefully scaled, I think they are here. I think there's just a lot more of them than you probably need once the porch is simplified, which that's going to help. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing I was going to say is this kind of Palladian window on the front facing mass there is a little peculiar, one, because the transoms, and two, because it's all picture windows or casements, one or the other. And when you look at all those precedent images, it's almost always pairs of double hungs and big double hungs. So I don't want to tell you which way to go with those, but that, stylistically speaking, if you look back at those precedent, there may be something that fits better with the house in some of those other images.
Yeah, and you're right that a lot of times I will opt for a casement or fixed in the attic windows because I'm scaling the window down.
Yeah, I don't. And there's not a problem. It's just that six window assembly there in the middle with the square transoms, and you got the rectangular. They're all fixed. It's going to look like a big picture window unit. And I think, historically speaking, if you look at Stick, Queen Anne, all the Victorians, you see a lot more kind of pairs of giant tall double hungs, which you have on the other elevation.
Okay. Anything else?
One other comment, and that would be on the corner window. So the corner window looks like it kind of matches the what you're showing, the big front picture window. And I think
where are you talking about? Here?
Is that the
are you talking
porch?
About on the right
and
side?
That's actually a screen that's porch
that's
window.
A screen porch.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. All right. So when you come to us, we'll have drawings that show us the different views.
Yeah. Okay.
I think
yes,
to me,
definitely.
That's the key is we got to see those side elevations in context for me because it just... It's hard to know how prominent.
Well, I think that would be. I think that what the intention is once we get to a voting meeting. So, it would be good if you're coming back to DRC to just
to have the 3Ds.
Want to have it.
Mm-hmm. And not only that, within the context of, can you remind us the ones that we've already had a chance to review our numbers? Okay, so some rendering where we can see those next to each other would be really helpful.
Okay, absolutely.
Okay, anything else on this one? Then let's move on to 1847 William Campbell Court, Lot 8.
So, Lot 8. What I was seeking to do here was to provide something that was quieter, stately, and looking at the rhythm of the street. You know, of course, we just looked at Lot 5, and with some of the houses, there are things going on. So I was trying to see what I could do with a minimum of ornament and just work with the proportion. I felt that the stone was very important, in order to add that presence. And, you know, I looked at the precedent of the mansion itself, the garage. So there's, I believe there's material continuity with the mansion. Simple square columns. And as you can see, slight battering of the walls, slight angling of those walls at the front gable. And that is all I have as far as comments.
Staff.
Thank you. I don't really have too many additional comments. Just wanted to highlight the kind of the overall height. It does say max height, 32 feet. That's at the roof ridge. So there is that chimney to kind of factor in still. So just overall height would be good to note on here as well. And just to also highlight the transom windows along the first floor. We've discussed those in the past. I think this was marked as a Tudor style. Is that correct?
I think I called it a cottage with Tudor influences.
Okay. I would also, just from seeing it, also just kind of roughly arts and crafts with the use of stone in there as well. So I just think the transoms, again, as we've discussed in the past, is maybe a little bit too ornate. But I'll leave that to the commission to offer their opinions as well.
Okay, Susan?
I would agree with Joey that the changing those with that window configuration to the left bay would help. The shed roof dormer seems a little cumbersome. That's the right word, but it just seems like it's overpowering on that roof line. But I think overall you've captured the feel of these houses. But I would like to see that window configuration change and something with that shed roof dormer. It just really seems to be really large for that. If you look at the windows even relative to the roof, and it may just be that because of the angle, you know, it being a straight on elevation. That's my comments. Thank you.
Okay. Josh?
Same comments. The other thing I would just note, like when comparing to the inspiration photos in that peak there, and it looks like it transitions from stone to wood, and that may be fine, but I'm definitely not seeing that in the inspiration photos of the examples of similar stone. So that's it for me.
Brian?
So your front door, if you look at your inspirational photos, at least two of them show the front door with side lights, and you don't really get that feel with what's shown in this drawing. You get like almost three windows across for your entrance. And I think if that became a main entrance door with satellites, it would help the structure.
And I agree. In fact, we changed that to that exactly. So it's now a central door with flanking windows. I wanted to have that whole foyer be all glazing and very open, but it's been achieved with the side lights. So,
and the height comments, you know, really, you round this up, it's 32 feet. It's the same height as Magnolia Hall, so it does need to come down.
It is significantly lower on the side.
So elevation-wise. You have any idea? So if you took Magnolia Hall and its roof line and you draw a straight line out toward this house, its proposed height, what would that difference be?
So I'm talking about that, we can find that out. I'm going to get that for you.
We don't have those heights.
And I'm like, who is Mike? Mike's not here.
But that would be very helpful.
Absolutely. So we had a graphic. I don't know that it had
it's
overall.
Not in this package.
Oh, okay.
It was an earlier package.
I thought we did submit
It's that. 8 or 9. 9 is...
I hate to rely on my memory, but I believe 9 is 2 feet lower than the mansion, and I believe this is something like 8 inches or a foot lower. That's according to my memory.
This is 1847, right, on the address?
Yes.
Yeah. I have that. I pulled that up. It says it's 1 foot different.
Okay.
So that would make it just a foot below, on a sight line, Magnolia Hall. There's still a lot of roof, just a consideration.
I definitely hear you on that, and I'll take a look at that. The major element on this that I think visually establishes the perceived height, perhaps even more so than that, the ridge of the cross gable is that front facing gable. Because of you know, perspective and foreshortening and how the and elevations, as you know, roofs appear more imposing or larger than they are in real life. So I believe that might be a mitigating factor in that consideration, but I'll definitely take another look at it.
Okay, Lisa.
Ms. Besser's comment regarding the massive impression of that shed is something that we hope you might be able to adapt into something else. And if it looks massive from this perspective, then it's also going to look massive, I think, in comparison to the historic Magnolia Hall.
I think it'll help you to see the 3D of it. You can tell from the shadow that it's a radiused roof, which softens it and brings it a little bit lower than it otherwise would be, or it reduces its mass somewhat. But as you can tell, there's a bit of wall each side of the windows, and so I can definitely look at reducing the width of that. And
what did you mean by the radius? I'm not familiar with the radius.
The shed roof is not a straight slope, but it mm-hmm. it's a curved. It's a swoopy roof. Swoopy roof.
Okay.
Is the official cat term. Slide. There you go, cat slide. So that is a real. That's a good term. I like that. Brings up a good visual.
Okay, well, some other renderings would be helpful.
Scott?
No comments at this time.
Okay, I
skip me.
Hmm? No, I'm coming up. Comment on the overall height, that's a concern. They bring that down. I do think whatever you call that shed dormer, that needs to be either adjusted or shown differently so we can better understand that.
Okay.
I do like to comment on the doors that Brian made, have the door with the side lights as in your two of those inspiration mm-hmm. photos.
Yeah.
And I think that was it.
Okay.
I think that's it. So anything else from?
You skipped me.
You're getting there.
Well, I had one follow-up, and then we'll have Tyler on leave. So on the side lights.
Oh, you didn't?
No.
Oh, I thought you. I'm sorry.
I'm just being patient. I go last.
You had talked so much. I just thought you'd already covered it.
I'll throw mine in really quick. You said you corrected the side, or you had altered the side lights to show side lights, but that's not what we're seeing today, right? That's in something
correct.
You haven't submitted. Okay.
Correct.
I just want to make sure, because if those were fixed side lights, then they were, I think, too big for what everybody's saying.
I continue to refine things forever. And
Tyler, please.
Oh, thank you. what's that roof pitch of that front gable? Is like a 14, 12?
I think it's 14.
Is the cross gable the same or is it lower?
It's 12.
12, okay.
It's quite common to have that cross gable be a lower pitch.
Yeah.
I'd like to guard against having it too much lower. At some point, it starts looking
Well, at some point, you don't have any upstairs left to use. So this dormer, I mean, I don't have a problem with the swoopy roof. I think it's definitely in a 2D drawing. Looks like it goes way up on the roof, which it does, but it becomes parallel to that roof as well. So seeing it in 3D will help. It still might need some adjustment, but what's this dormer made out of, like the wall of the dormer? Is it stucco or what is it?
Stucco, I think last time we discussed it, it was stucco. I was considering stucco or else tongue and groove horizontal tongue and groove wood, but I think we're landing on stucco.
Yeah, I think just overall my reaction to I mean, I like the stucco dormer would be beautiful if it's real stucco and done really well and the windows are detailed really well into it.
I don't think it should be that hardy panel. I think it would need
to
be real.
No, you don't want my opinions on hardy. I think the wood detail on the top of the gable is kind of like the last one we looked at. If we're going for a simple aesthetic, I think taking the stone all the way up is just a simple way to do it and let these forms, which are beautiful, and you have this steep roof, just let it be what it is, and really spend the time and energy on detailing those masonry openings, maybe with a nicer than just plain old typical brick mold or something, doing something that's just richer in the fine details than trying to introduce maybe materials that somebody has to worry about maintaining for the next 100 years. I agree with the windows, some of the comments. The transoms, I mean, you've got, what are we at, 10-foot ceilings? Is that where most of the houses landed? I think they were 12 at one point. Mm-hmm. I think simplifying those to letting them be big and prominent, nice pieces of glass is the simpler, more elegant way to do it. And again, detailing lintels and sills out of, you know, nice pieces of stone, whether it's cut Indiana or, you know, some type of whatever you're using, Tennessee farm rock bands. So it's just something really nice and classic. I think will be more timeless than what to me seems sort of fatty. These, you know, boards lined up in the gable could go out. That kind of stuff could be could be fads. You don't know. But those are my comments. The dormer, I don't mind the width of the dormer. I think it really is about, you know, it looks like a lot of roof. I'd like to see it in 3D, and I know it's going back quite a ways, but in 2D, it looks like it's in our face a little bit. So that's it.
All right.
So I have a follow-up with that on material. So I was assuming the stone hadn't been finished, like, on the gable part, and it was going to be stone up in the where the dormer is. And then, so that does that mean that the chimney was going to be stucco as well?
Stone.
No, stone.
It would be stone.
Mm-hmm. Anything else? All right, let's move on to the last one, which is 1849 William Campbell Court, Lot 9.
You've seen this before, and one of the issues has been is that porch a real porch or is that a not real porch? In the precedent photo that this is inspired by, it's a false porch. Part of that is driven by how we're continuing to look at and detail the. That would be the lower left is the main inspiration photo. Beyond that, not a lot to say. I'm just going for that southern, I guess you'd call it classic revival. I think it has some Queen Anne massing going on. It's not a true classic revival. You know, it's got more of the roof slopes and such of Queen Anne. One of these classicized Queen Anne's. Welcome your comments.
Okay, staff.
Again, not too much to add with this one. We've seen this before at a DRC, as Mr. Smith said. I think overall, this one especially has kind of heeded the feedback of minimalism is more, especially with these houses. We've talked about the double columns on front porches before with some of the other homes. Personally, I think with the simpler Doric columns, it is okay with this particular design. And just kind of as a general note, we would classify this as a two-story and not a one and a half. They are allowed to go up to two stories with their approved development plan and site plan. And they've done a lot of design work to bring down the perceived height so it doesn't read as a full two-story, but just that front form there, we would classify it as a two-story house. And I think we've discussed this before, but I believe at the last DRC, we concluded that this upper form is in line with the front door below it. Just a little hard to tell with just the front on elevation. So again, I think maybe a 3D of this one as well would go a long way to just kind of show the various forms and how everything lines up with each other. And again, just the transom along the first floor again, wanted to point out, and 29 feet 8 inches to the roof ridge, but then you do have a taller chimney over to the right. So that's really about it for this. So I'll turn over to commission.
Okay, Scott, your comments?
No comments at this time.
Lisa?
Did you say that porch was not a functional porch? Or the one, the upper one?
The second floor?
Yeah. Or balcony? I guess
currently, as drawn, it is not.
Is that consistent with any of the other homes you've designed for that area, or...? For the Magnolia Hall.
Oh, to mean to have a functioning second floor porch?
To have that detail.
That's unique to that home. I don't have that on any of the other homes. Mm-hmm. Lot 11 has a walkout porch over the screened porch that's mm-hmm. facing to the side, but none of them have anything to the front mm-hmm. like this. Mm-hmm.
Again, looking for simplicity and guarding against detracting from the historic mansion, that particular detail seems to complicate the design, and there might be a way to accomplish what you're looking for without that particular detail. And again, a rendering of this in context would be very, very helpful.
Okay. Tyler.
I was flipping back and forth between the plan and the elevation. There's this hyphenated porch rack with the little finials where the porch rack steps up at the front door. Mm-hmm. And then there's lines on the outside of that, but in the plan, it doesn't jut forward at all like the precedent. Is this intended just flat across the front?
We were thinking it would come out. I think we just hadn't adjusted the plan to work within the setbacks just yet.
I think it is important that it steps out a little bit. We have we have to take a little bit of space out of the house itself to make that work. So we're working on that.
And the reason I was asking is because I was wondering how many columns there were, if there were some behind others. So you intend on probably having three at those corners. Okay.
Correct.
I don't see a problem with that. I'm just trying to understand what the intent is here. This style of house, you know, we've talked about transoms and things. On this one, I've seen houses like this that have transoms on it. It's a little different beast. And then, you know, I look at this funny little window in the gable, and you see it on the precedent image. And I was surprised to see it on the historic house. If that house is historic, I think it is.
It is.
But it's just a funny little window. So I was like, that's kind of a novelty of sorts, which can be fun, but can also be like, where the heck did that come from? When a house is obviously old and you see quirky things, we're surprised and we kind of laugh about it. When we see it, a quirky thing on a new house, you go, you know, where did that come from? So it is a little peculiar to see this little Gothic arch window on this house.
I know that is, there can be a higher risk in that. I do believe in including that because that is such a feature of this time period, the quirky, little quirky gestures. And it's, I agree with you, it's something has to be done carefully and thoughtfully. In this case, it helped that I can see what it looks like on the precedent image. Yeah. On the earlier version, it was rectangular and it just looked flat. It just didn't have the same.
Yeah.
It seemed lacking. I agree with you on the last house we looked at. As I look at it again, I don't know if I want to do the transom window route on 8, but on this one, as you mentioned, I think if there is one house where the transoms are most important, I would say it would be this house, even though the precedent house that I'm being inspired by does not have them. And if you would compare this with the other one, I'm making it a little more formal in certain ways, and namely that, really.
Yeah.
Got anything else?
No, not right now.
Brian?
So height, even though I noticed this, if you round it up, it'd be close to 30. Its elevation, I think, is 6 feet below. So we don't think we have really an issue with height where this one's concerned.
Okay, great.
So that might help with the chimney as well. I wanted to ask about just the siding reveal. So this is going to be probably a hardy board siding. What reveal had you thought about for this one?
I think it's going to be cedar rather than hardy. I don't like the hardy. It looks a little flat. It's fine on some houses, but especially in a house of this scale.
I think that's a good choice.
And in terms of the reveal, I'd be interested in your thought. I mean, I see two different, I could see it as a 4-inch, you know, 4-inch is the standard reveal for this street, which suggests more of a Victorian or let's say, I could also see a wider, like a 7-inch reveal, which in my mind anyway is more of a colonial revival kind of width. I do have 8-inch, the corner trim is detailed to be almost like a simplified pilaster with small trim detail at the top of it. So that's, the corners are bulky or scaled up. So what do you all think about?
Well, the reason I asked, I'm looking at your inspirational photo and you have a very narrow reveal. And if you look on West Main Street here in Franklin, there's several houses that Frank Craig built in the early part of the 20th century, and they have a very narrow reveal.
Is it less than 4, do you think?
It's less, oh, definitely less.
You think it's like 3 or?
At least that narrow.
Or I'm just thinking,
since you showed that on, you know, your inspirational photo, I didn't know where you were going.
If that's the right thing to do, then I would do that. I mean, if that looked right.
But those are my only questions and comments. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. I think I'll echo what the others have said and not belabor it, hopefully. But I actually, on the inspirational photo, it does look like there are transoms, at least on the front. But one thing that may make a difference is none of these look like they really have a bunch of, I'm going to mess it up, the grid and the windows, the mullions
the muttons
or whatever you want to call it. So maybe that's making it look busier. I would say the little asterisks in the rail, while that's kind of fun, I do think that that starts to just look, I mean, I'm just afraid some of those things, if you just tone that down a little bit, it might avoid questions about, are we competing with Magnolia Hall? So on this one, personally, looking at it with the inspiration photo, I don't mind the transoms. I just think you can see how when you zoom in on that, it just looks less busy because there's less grid going on.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's... Do you like it? Would you like to have it be more like the inspiration photo and
I like
no
the
grid?
I mean, I think for that, that's really attractive and clean and a little bit less busy. But mm-hmm. I don't mind a big plate glass window.
I see that.
So.
Susan?
The thing that I'm wrestling with, is that a dormer on the second story? Is the three windows and the gable roof, is that a dormer?
I think it's an intersecting gable.
Because I'm not saying, I can't, from the first floor plan, I can't really tell what's going on. But my point is that I feel like it's overpowering this elevation. And I feel like that it could be scaled down some, not a lot. But I think just scaling it down, because again, it's the first thing I see when I look at the elevation, I don't see the front doors. And it seems to me like I should see the front doors rather than that first. So that would be my, you know, my recommendation. And the double columns don't bother me. This is like you're patterning this under. In fact, Tyler and I were just talking about the Dozier house earlier, which was the old funeral home, and it was our Omo Shore house. And that was pretty classic, and that was, you know, double columns. And I think in this case, this house really calls for double columns. So those are my comments. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. If I could just respond really quick, staff would not consider this a dormer. It would be the second story.
Okay.
That's what we would review it as.
Thank you.
Only question I've got. You talk about the chimney. It just looks like it's, from this perspective, looks like it's just a big tower.
It might be too tall. I've brought the chimneys down to close to code minimum, and it looks like I'd have to take another look at that, but
I mean, there may be a great reason for it.
I think you're right. I think it might be able to. I made a note of that too, to take a look at that, bring it down.
Okay, I don't have any other comments on this.
Okay,
nothing else, Matt. Thank you.
Okay, well, thanks. Thank you, thanks for your comments. I appreciate it.
Thanks, Al.
All right, there's nothing. Yes, Kelly.
Just one more thing. Just a reminder that we have a special DRC next Monday, the 28th at 4:00 here, to focus on the middle eight proposal that's gearing up for a COA review. Thank you.
Thank you. Hearing nothing else, we're adjourned. Thank you.